Baptist Church, so good to see you all here. We are looking forward to a great time together, a great time of worship, of singing together, of praying together, and also of hearing God's word proclaimed. Thank you that you have made time to be here with us. Welcome also to those joining us via live stream video, wherever you may be. We are glad to have you with us as we worship together this morning. We invite you to join us as we open our service by singing together, "Brethren, we have met to worship." Let's all stand together this morning.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Brethren, see poor sinners round you slumbering on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving. Can you bear to let them go? Our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then He'll call us home to heaven. At His table we'll sit down. Christ will gird Himself and serve us with sweet manna all around. Immortal, invisible God, only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes, most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, Thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as light, nor wanting, nor wasting, Thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, Thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life Thou givest, to both great and small, in all life Thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but not change of thee.
Thank you. You may be seated this morning. The book of Hebrews, chapter 11, that particular chapter is sometimes called the Hall of Fame of Faith. It's a recounting of how so many throughout the history of humanity and throughout the Old Testament demonstrated faith, trust, confidence, assurance in God. We wouldn't have time to read the whole chapter today, but one verse stands out to me. Verse 8 says that by faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out not knowing whither he went. That is, Abraham was called to leave a place that he knew and that was home and where he was comfortable. He was called to go somewhere totally different, not even knowing what it might be or what it might be like. But by faith and by trust, he obeyed God and followed and served him. That call is still to us today, to trust him completely with all that we are and to obey him with singleness of heart. Him completely, we obey and follow him, and we also uplift and praise him. Join us as we sing this old hymn, I Will Praise Him. Let's sing together. I will praise him.
that my feet in ashes lay. I will praise him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give him glory, O people, for his blood can wash away.
Together this morning. Father, Lord, as we gather before you, we do offer these hymns of joy, of praise, of thanks, Lord, of recognition of who you are. We acknowledge you as the one, the only living God and Savior, our Creator, our Master, and our Lord. We acknowledge you as preeminent and as sovereign and as the authority over all that is, because you are the Creator of all that is. We also submit and confess, Lord, that we know that physically we are but dust and ashes, Lord. We are your servants, and solely by your grace, we have the privilege of being your children. Not that we've earned that or could earn it, but because of your grace and your mercy and your love, you have given us this privilege of being called your children. Be merciful unto us as sinners, O Lord, as we know that we all too often violate your laws and your commandments and your precepts and your principles. All too often we are weak in faith, not following the example set for us, but being world-minded. Oh Lord, please be merciful to us as sinners. Forgive us of our failures. Help us to learn and to grow and to mature, that we might be more like you, that we might honor you and please you in all that we think, all that we say and all that we do. We are only saved purely because of your grace. Lord, we know that we are to trust you and obey you with all that we are. Help us to be a people who walk by faith. Thank you for the power and the authority and the life that dwells within your word. We pray for our pastor as he comes forward and as he opens the Bible, as he proclaims from your word, prepare us, Lord, to be ready to hear and to receive. Convict us, Lord, of our failures. Help us to grow in maturity. Help us to be ready to go forth from this place and to share your love and your light with all whom we interact. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. May your will be done in every way. And we pray this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Pastor.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Thrasher. Take your copy of God's Word and let's go to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6. I'm going to look at verses 12 through 16. The message entitled, Choosing Nobodies. Now, maybe when you were younger, you played a game called kickball. I remember playing kickball, loved playing kickball. But I also remember there were people in kickball who were not chosen first. They were chosen last. Now, you may say, Pastor, you brought up some hurtful memories. Well, I'm sorry, but it is what it is. In fact, it reminded me of an episode of my favorite TV show growing up, Home Improvement. And Tim and Jill's oldest son, Brad, had a little girlfriend, Jennifer. And apparently, they had had an argument because he did not pick her for his kickball team. So she confronted him about this and said, Bradley, why did you not choose me for your team? And he said, why did you choose this other girl? And he said, because she's good. I wanted to win. You know, and that is how many people are not only treated simply in kickball, but in life. David, King David, was a nobody. He simply was a shepherd who's tending his father's field when God tells prophet Samuel, this is going to be my chosen person to be the next king of Israel. Samuel said, well, he doesn't look like much of a king. God says in 1 Samuel 16:7, he says, Samuel, man looks on the outward appearance, but I look at the heart. In fact, friend, God is in the business of choosing nobodies with hearts that are tender and pure and spirits willing to listen and serve him. Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 29. He says, for consider your calling, brethren, that there were not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong, and the base things of the world and the despised. God has chosen the things that are not, so that he may nullify the things that are, so that no man can boast before God. A great author, Oswald Chambers, many years ago, picks up on this idea. And he says, quote, all through history, God has chosen and used nobodies because their unusual dependence on him made possible the unique display of God's power and grace. He chose and used somebodies, listen, only when they renounced dependence on their natural abilities and resources, end quote. You see, as people, we're used to choosing the most popular, the most gifted to accomplish our ends. But God is not like us. In fact, when God is looking for individuals to serve him, he's looking at the people at the bottom of the totem pole. He's looking at the people who are over here and afraid to speak in public. He's over here looking at those who say, well, I can't pray. He's over here looking at those over here who have physical disabilities. And he's saying, these are the exact people I want to serve me. And we say as people, well, Lord, they're just not going to work out because they're nobodies. Friend, I want you to listen very carefully. The world may consider you a nobody, but you are a somebody for whom Jesus died. God could have chosen anybody, but he is looking for people who will serve, this is my word, as his bodies to tell everybody about Jesus. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12:9 that my strength is made perfect in weakness. Would you stand this morning as we out of the reading of God's holy word? Luke 6, beginning in verse 12. Now understand, Jesus has just come out of two Sabbath stories where he has had some conflict with religious leaders. And the Bible says it was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray, and he spent the whole night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also named as apostles. Simon, whom he also named Peter, and Andrew his brother, and James and John and Philip and Bartholomew, and Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon who was called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. O God in heaven, Father, we thank you that you look down from your glorious state, and Father, you see us for who we really are. All of us are at one time in our life nobodies. And Father, may we see that in our state as nobodies, you look at us as people who are somebodies. And you loved us so much that you sent your one and only Son, Jesus, to die for us. Lord, I pray this morning that we would be encouraged and we would be challenged and moved to response. Father, with hearts unified, seeking to serve you. And certainly, Lord, if there's someone here this morning who's never given their heart to Jesus, Lord, I ask today would be the day of their salvation. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. May God honor and bless the reading of his word. You may be seated. Now, before Jesus chooses 12 nobodies, the Bible says that he prioritizes prayer. You go back to Luke chapter 5, verse 16, and the Bible tells us that oftentimes Jesus would slip away to the wilderness and pray. Jesus spoke to God for both the big things and he spoke to God for the small things in life. The decisions that he had to make in life, before he made them, he always asked God, what is your will? What do you want me to do, Father? Now notice, Jesus doesn't ask around to find out who would work best as apostles. He doesn't seek out the most popular. He doesn't seek out those who are polished in their speaking abilities. He doesn't look at the ones who have more charismatic personalities. He doesn't look at those who are well-to-do. But the Bible says that Jesus takes everything in his life to God in prayer. And the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, that's the same thing we should do. Whether they're big things, whether they're small things, we are to take those issues to God in prayer. Jesus says in Matthew 6, 8 that he knows what we need even before we ask it. Isn't that cool? But he wants to hear us verbally speak to him and in our hearts to speak and commune with him, because God seeks a relationship. And a relationship is a two-way communication. It's not just one way or one way. It's both ways. But I want you to realize this morning that Jesus had been praying about this issue. It's not something that Jesus thought to himself, man, this is the night before, I've got to cram. I've got to pray hard now. But Jesus had been praying all along, and I believe this was the bookend to his prayer. And the Bible says here that he spent the whole night in prayer. That means that this was not a thoughtless prayer. It was a prayer that was well thought out. It was a prayer that was organized. It was a prayer that was developed in its depth. It was intense. Because Jesus knew three things, and look at your outline because you may want to fill these in. Jesus knew that following him would require surrender, sacrifice, and selflessness. He knew that. He knew that not only for his apostles then, but he knew it for the disciples to follow, and he knows it for us today. It's not easy being a believer in Jesus Christ. In fact, every day, if you begin looking at the news as a Christian, if you're not careful, you can become very discouraged because of the way that believers are being treated in our own nation. Looked down upon, scorned, ridiculed, and you ask, why in the world is that happening? Because we're believers. That's what Jesus says would happen. It's not shock to him. But he knew this would be difficult. He also knew that following him would lead to ostracization from society. There would be outcasts, obstacles for service, and overwhelming situations that in their own strength they could not deal with. Have you ever been in a place in your life where it was too great for you to deal with? The doctors couldn't help you. You needed God, and he alone could answer. But Jesus also knew that following him would lead to valleys of faithfulness. You say, valleys of faithfulness, Pastor? Oh, yeah. Have you ever had low days, but you're still faithful to God? Valleys of faithfulness, because we realize that in those valleys we see victory over fears. Jesus promises to always be with us. He tells his disciples in Matthew 28:20, I will always be with you. The Father in the Old Testament assured his people, I will always be with you. I will never leave you, never forsake you. In John 16:7, Jesus tells the disciples right before he gets ready to ascend and sit at the right hand of the Father and die. He says, I am going to send the Comforter, my advocate, the Holy Spirit to you. And the Holy Spirit is God's power at action in our lives. We see in Acts chapter 1, verse 24, when Judas commits suicide, there are 11 apostles remaining. The apostles believe they need to have one to fill in that number. And the Bible says they prayed about it. And God led them to a man named Matthias. The priority of prayer should characterize every major and every minor decision of our lives. Now, before Jesus chose the 12 nobodies, they were nobodies. Before Jesus ever chose the 12, they were nobodies. In fact, the 12 apostles represented the 12 tribes of Israel. The Bible says that they were called out, or Mark 3:14 says, sent out. That's what apostle literally means. And Acts uses the term apostle to identify people who surrendered their lives to Jesus Christ. Now, I believe that the official role of apostle no longer exists for two primary reasons. Acts chapter 1, verses 21 and 22, the Bible says there were two requirements for being an apostle. Number one, you had to have walked with Jesus during his earthly ministry. Now, some of you may be a little older, but I don't think you're that old. And second, you had to have seen the risen Lord Jesus. Now that leads us to ask the question, well, why is Paul considered an apostle? There's a special category for Paul. And we see this in Galatians chapter 1, 15 and 16. And the Bible says these two things about Paul. Number one, he did see Jesus after Jesus was resurrected. We know this because Jesus appeared to him in a vision on the way to Damascus. But then there's a second thing, according to Galatians 1, 15 and 16. It says that Paul was commissioned to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those are the two reasons why Paul is included as an apostle. In fact, in Acts chapter 14, verse 4, not only Paul, but also Barnabas is called an apostle. Now, there are at least three characteristics of the 12 nobodies. Number one, they represented the common man. There were no religious leaders included amongst them. And I believe this is an indictment against the religious leaders and the religious structure of the people of God in that day. Because so many of the religious leaders cared nothing about God, they only cared about themselves. I believe that was a direct indictment against them. Second, the disciples were not religious scholars. In fact, after Jesus ascends to sit at the right hand of the Father, in Acts chapter 4, verse 20, Peter and John are arrested. But the Bible tells us when they're placed before a council, that the council concludes this in Acts chapter 4, verse 13. They observed the confidence of Peter and John and understood they were uneducated and untrained men. They were amazed and began recognizing them, listen, as having been with Jesus. I'll just stop right there and say, I could preach a message on that. Have you been with Jesus? Because friend, I want you to know, when you spend time with Jesus, your speech changes. Your thoughts change. Your outlook on life changes. You say, well, I'm not experiencing that. Then friend, I will tell you the truth. You're not spending the time with Jesus you need to spend. The Bible says that when we spend time with Jesus, we always come away changed. Always. Friend, if you can interact with the living God and not be changed, you've not interacted with the living God. Third, these were ordinary men. Yes, they were common. They represented the common man, but these men were ordinary. They were simple. There were no qualities in their life that made them stand out. They had average jobs. They were average people. In fact, if they were individuals that we might be looking for to lead an organization, they would probably not be the ones we chose. They wouldn't have been the brightest eggs in the basket. Might not have been the most polished. Might not have been the best looking. Might not have been the most physically intimidating. But each one of these men was qualified by Jesus to serve. I want you to listen very carefully. You may not have what you think it takes to serve Jesus, but friend, when Jesus calls you to serve, He qualifies you for that service. Everything that you don't have, God is able to bless you with. If we will be faithful, Jesus will equip us with everything that we need to be faithful to Him and the calling that He gives us in life. Now, I want to look very quickly at the 12 nobodies that were called out for Jesus. I could spend an entire message on individuals or part of these apostles, but I don't have time to do that. And so what I'm going to do is, with a very broad stroke, summarize their life and their ministry. I want to say that in the New Testament, there are four lists of apostles. One is Matthew chapter 10, verses 2 through 4. The second is Mark chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. We have Luke 6, 13 through 16. And then finally, Acts chapter 1, verse 13. You may ask, Pastor, you didn't have to give us that. No, but it sure does help if you want to do some study this week and go back and look at those 12 lists on your own time. That helps, doesn't it? Say thank you, Brother Brian. There you go. Well, you're welcome. It's a blessing to be a pastor of such a wonderful, gracious people. All right, the 12 apostles. First, Peter. Peter's most likely the most well-known of the 12. And the Bible says he first met Jesus through his brother Andrew in John chapter 1. The Bible says that when Andrew found out who Jesus was, the first thing he did was to go out and find his brother Simon. That is Peter, and he brought him to Jesus. That'll preach. How many of you, when you found Jesus, went and found somebody else and brought them to Jesus? Silence. But friends, we ought to be bringing people to Jesus because of the change in our lives that He has made. Now, Peter wanted to have faith, but oftentimes he would struggle. In fact, on one occasion in Matthew 14, verses 28 through 31, Peter's in a boat on water, and he sees Jesus walking on the water. This amazes Peter, and so he gets out of the boat, and he begins running over to Jesus. But the cool thing is that Peter is on top of the water. But all of a sudden, the wind began to kick up just a little bit, and Peter realized this was not natural. And Peter looked down, and the Bible says when he looked down and took his eyes off of Jesus, that he sank. But Jesus caught him, and he looked at Peter and said, Peter, why did you have such little faith? You see, that's where so many of us are in our own lives. When we take our eyes off of Jesus, we begin doubting. We begin questioning. We begin saying things like, Lord, where are you? Why aren't you taking care of me? God, why did you allow this to happen? God, why aren't you doing this? God, why aren't you there? Peter later confessed Jesus as Lord in Matthew 16, 15 to 16. Peter says, Jesus, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. But what's interesting is that just a few verses later in verse 23, he tells Jesus, hey, Jesus, by the way, you don't need to die. That's a bad thing if you die. And of course, Jesus looks at Peter and says, get behind me, Satan. I think sometimes as God's people, we tend to give God bad advice. Because God doesn't need our advice, does he? But oh, as God's people, we should seek his counsel. And we should seek his ways. The Bible says that his faith without Christ was weak. Matthew 26, 34, Jesus said, Peter, you will deny me three times. And that's exactly what Peter did when Jesus was placed on trial. But later, after Jesus was raised to life, he goes to Peter in John chapter 21, verses 15 through 17. And he reconciles. He reconciles Peter to himself. After Jesus ascends to sit at the right hand of the Father, Peter becomes the leader of the 12. That's a brief summary of Peter. Now, his brother Andrew, you could argue, was the first, Andrew and John, of the apostles. They were John the Baptist's disciples, and they came to follow Jesus when they found out who he was. Andrew wanted other people to know Jesus personally. Now, James, his brother of John, and James was one of three that was mentored by Jesus. Jesus had 12 apostles, but he had three whom he mentored: Peter, James, and John. James later became the first martyr of the apostles. James also had a problem with his temper. He was known as a son of thunder. Maybe that's what your parents knew you as, or a daughter of opinions. You know, I don't know. But even James and John go to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, who's going to sit at your right hand? So these men, even though they were called out, they struggle with things just like us. Jesus, who do you really love more? Well, James' brother John, the Bible says he was the disciple whom Jesus loved. Now, does that mean he loved him more than anyone else? No. But it means that Jesus had a very special relationship with John. In fact, to the best of our knowledge of history, every apostle except John and Judas died in martyrdom. However, you could say that John died in martyrdom. He was exiled to the island of Patmos. Now, what many people don't realize is that he was released before he died. He goes to Ephesus, what we believe, and he lives out his final days in Ephesus in poor health. Judas killed himself. But the apostle John wrote five books in the New Testament: John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and then the book of Revelation. How about Philip? The Bible says in John chapter 1 that Philip meets Jesus in Galilee. The Bible later says in John 14:8, he says to Jesus, Jesus, we want to see the Father. And Jesus says, Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Well, Philip, when he found out who Jesus was, just like Andrew, he brings a friend of his, Bartholomew, or Matthew, I believe, puts his name as Nathanael. And in John 1, 46 through 49, Jesus convinces him that he is the Messiah, and Bartholomew surrenders his life to Jesus, convinced that he is the Messiah. Matthew was a tax collector. I preached a message a few weeks ago on, after he found Jesus, he threw a party for those people who were lost. Thomas, I preached a message on him just a few short weeks ago on Easter. He was known as Doubting Thomas. In John 14, 5, he was looking for the way. He said, Jesus, how are we going? If we don't know where you're going, how do we know the way? And then he says in John 20, 28, my Lord and my God, after he sees Jesus raised to life. Now, three of the apostles we don't know much about: James, the son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and then Judas, the son of James. Now, I will say, Judas, the son of James, is specifically designated, and it's clarified that he is not Judas Iscariot. Because let me tell you, if you had Judas and somebody asked, are you one of the 12, and they'd heard what you did, they might have been upset with you. So he was Judas, the son of James. But then there was Judas Iscariot. And the Bible says that he betrayed Jesus. Now I want you to listen carefully to what Jesus says in John 15, 16. Because you might be thinking this morning, well, you know, I see myself as worthy of Jesus. Why doesn't he call upon me? Well, friend, let me share with you, Jesus wants to call upon all people to be saved. But he gives you a free will to discern whether or not you'll say yes to him. Jesus in John chapter 15, verse 16 says this, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit and that your fruit would remain so that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give to you. You see, it's Jesus who calls us as his. But as a well-known pastor, Adrian Rogers, used to say, Jesus chooses us, but we have to choose our choosing. Friend, you can respond to Jesus Christ by faith, or you can reject Jesus Christ and say, I don't want anything to do with you. But when you respond to God's calling upon your life to be his child, friend, I want to tell you, you enter into a totally different dimension of blessing and identity. Because you begin to see that you do have purpose. You're not just floating around and waffling around. As so many in our world are searching for today, why do you think people post things on social media? Because they want you to like it, to give them affirmation of who they are. I heard a person who was struggling with sexual identity recently. He said, well, so-and-so told me that this is who I was, and so that must be who I am. Friend, you are not who people tell you you are. You are who God says that you are. But you can choose to accept that, or you choose to reject it. Friend, I want you to know that God can overcome any weakness in our life to accomplish his purposes. I'm thankful this morning that my God is still in the business of calling out nobodies to serve him. And I want to quickly give you five traits or five characteristics of contemporary disciples. Number one, they're born again. You may ask, Pastor, why did you include that? Because you know what? If you're not saved, you can't be a disciple. The Bible says in John 3:3, unless any man is born again, except a man is born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Friend, unless you've been born again and forgiven of your sin, unless you've received Jesus Christ by faith and been changed, you can't walk with Jesus. And friend, if you've never done that, Jesus invites you to do that today. Second, the Bible says that we must be growing. In John 15, 8, the Bible says that Jesus has called us to bear fruit that will last. And the only way that you and I can bear fruit is if we're attached to the vine, and that's Jesus. And the good stuff of Christ is flowing in and through us. Third, we're called to love one another. Now, he's speaking specifically about brothers and sisters in Christ. John 13, 35 says, by this all men will know that you're my disciples if you have love one for another. Now, you've heard me say, we're called to love. We're never called to like everybody. But we're called to love our brothers and our sisters. Fourth, we are called to live surrendered lives. Or we're called to live surrendered. Listen to what Jesus says in Luke 14, verse 26. He says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciples. And many have stopped and said, hold on just a minute. I thought Jesus was a savior of love and not of hate. Friend, he is a savior of love and not of hate. But the idea of hatred here is not actually hating your mother and father, your brother and sister, or anyone else. But it is saying, no Jesus, no one, nothing will ever be put in a greater place of prominence and obedience in my life than you. Only you. But man, how often did Jesus get pushed to the back, right? He follows that up and he says in verse 27, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot not be my disciple. We live surrendered when we follow Jesus. And fifth, God's called us to be disciple makers. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 and 20, Jesus says, all authority has been given to me. So by the way, the authority is not in you. It's not in me. It's in Jesus, and Jesus gives us his word, which I don't care what anybody says, is the ultimate authority. Jesus says, all authority has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything I've commanded you. And I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. I hope this message today has encouraged you. Because if we're really honest with ourselves, every one of us is a nobody. In fact, the President of the United States is a nobody. The President of China is a nobody. The greatest athlete in this world is a nobody. For friend, when we all stand before God, we're going to have status. And it's going to be, we're either born again by Jesus Christ or we're lost. That's the only thing that matters. But what I'm thankful about this morning is that God looked at me as a nobody. And he said, Brian, I see you as more than that. There's an old gospel song, the Williams Brothers, and Casting Crowns, a contemporary group, has redone this song, different lyrics. I love both versions. One's kind of an old gospel spiritual, and this is the Casting Crowns is a more contemporary version, but this is what both of them say in the chorus. It says, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. And I want you to know that's exactly who we are and what God has called us to do with Jesus. Friend, no matter where you are this morning, you may think you're somebody. You may say, well, people have told me this and people have done this. I work for a company. I own my own business. I am a somebody. Friend, unless you know Jesus, you're the wrong kind of somebody. Because the somebody in the world's eyes is going to most likely spend eternity apart from Jesus if they don't have a relationship with Jesus. And I'm here to tell you, friend, I'd rather be a nobody in the world's eyes but a somebody in God's eyes. Maybe you're here today and you don't know who you are. You're struggling with a lot of things inside. You've listened to lies that hell has told you. Lies like, you're a nobody. You're not important. God doesn't love you. Friend, I'm here to tell you today by the authority of God's word and as his servant, Jesus died for you and me. He knew everything in our life that would ever take place. And God genuinely cares for us. The Bible says whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. The disciples did nothing to gain God's favor. Jesus chose them. You and I can do nothing to convince God we're worthy to follow him. Jesus died for everyone. And he says, friends, we've all sinned. Even the 12. And I want to tell you what I believe. Judas Iscariot, as our text today tells us, the traitor, the one who betrayed Jesus. I believe with all of my heart, if Judas had gone to Jesus and he stood there, even in disguise, at the bottom of the cross in tears and weeping, said, oh, Jesus, I'm so sorry, forgive me, forgive me. You know what Jesus, I believe with all of my heart, would have said? Judas, your sins are forgiven. But Judas didn't do that. He chose to live in guilt and pain. I want you to understand something this morning. If you leave without Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're choosing to live in guilt and in pain apart from the freedom and the joy that Jesus offers. Friend, it doesn't have to be that way. Why not today repent of your sin and ask Jesus to forgive you? Simply pray something like this in your heart. Lord Jesus, I know that I have sinned and done wrong. Forgive me. I repent. I repent, Lord. I believe with all of my heart that Jesus died for me and he was raised on the third day. And I am surrendering my life to you right now, Jesus. Come and take my life. I want you to have control of everything. Friend, why not pray something like that this morning and give God glory? Why not mean it? And through the power of the Holy Spirit, step out of the shadow of sin and its dominion in your life and step into the presence of the living God. Maybe you're here this morning, you've been looking for a church home for a while, and you've prayed about it, and you believe this is where God wants you to unite. Friend, in just a moment, we have an invitation. If you've received Jesus Christ by faith today, please come. I'll be right here. We'll have other ministers here. We want to celebrate what Jesus has done and what he's going to do in your life. But if you've prayed about it, you believe this is where God wants you tonight, wants you to unite with, I want you to understand, we'll be a bunch of nobodies together. But we're serving Jesus as his body. And may we do that as Jesus says in John 17, 21, as one. Not as different individuals, but as one body, unified under the lordship of Jesus Christ. You come this morning. Friend, if you need special prayer, the altar is always open that you can come and spend time with God. You can ask him about specific things in your own life. You could pray for others. You can come this morning and brag on Jesus and thank him. Thank him for calling you to be his. We'll always be glad to pray with you as ministers. Friend, whatever God is leading you to do, you come today. Maybe God's leading you into ministry and you think, well, preacher, God would never call me. I'm too old. I can't speak well. I don't have the voice of Billy Graham. Well, friend, let me tell you, it's not your abilities that God is after. God is after what you don't have, but what he can do through you. Will you step out in obedience and follow him? Or will you make excuses as to why you can't? Lord God, our heart this morning is to be faithful. And our heart this morning, God, is that you would move in and through our midst and we would respond and say yes to Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Would you stand this morning? As the Spirit of God leads, friend, you come and I'll be right here to meet you as you come. Would you be seated just one moment? I have two things I want to say before Miss Ivy Sewell comes and leads us in a very special prayer for our women's ministry, an event they're getting ready to have. And that is that May the 4th is the National Day of Prayer. And one of the things that we like to do here at Emmanuel Baptist Church is to build up the name of Jesus and lift that name high, especially in the National Day of Prayer, because, friends, we're not praying to any God, we're praying to the God. And so what we like to do, we began this last year, is we like to have a time of reading God's Word openly. We'll do it right out here. You say, well, Pastor, it's outside, I might get hot. Bring some water. It's okay to wear shorts and a t-shirt, okay? You don't need to wear a three-piece suit. But I want you to have an opportunity to read God's Word. If you have 15 minutes free, and I promise you, we'll have a large print Bible. For some of you, say, Pastor, I need the large print. We'll have that for you. But you come, if you can give 15 minutes of your day, 15 minutes, please go and sign up in the Family Life Center. You'll see two signs in the lobby. Andy Tindall, our prayer coordinator here at Emmanuel Baptist Church, he and Ms. Sharon are helping to coordinate that. And also, in conjunction with that, this year we're going to be doing something also in addition. We're going to be having 15-minute slots in our prayer room. If you could give 15 minutes either to read or 15 minutes to pray, we would ask you to do that. But we would love to have it down and scheduled so you'll have that time to spend with the Lord Jesus. Now, anyone can come that day and pray and spend time with God. But if you have 15 minutes or even 30 minutes, your pastor would ask that you come, be faithful in that ministry. Because I'm here to tell you, I believe that God answers His people. Do you believe that? It's what the Bible says. And I believe the Bible. Your pastor loves you. Find somebody this week. Tell them about Jesus. Miss Ivy, where are you? Would you come and lead us in prayer this morning?
We're so glad you worshiped with us this morning here at Emmanuel. If you're new, we would love to connect with you. Please fill out a Connect card found in the back of the seat in front of you and exchange it at our Connect table in the lobby where there's a gift waiting for you. If you made a decision today, that is amazing. We want to celebrate that with you. Let us know by filling out the Connect card indicating your decision or speak with one of the ministers after the service. Our women's ministry here at IBC is hosting a You, Me, and Tea, where they will be participating in a purse-packing project that serves women in need by providing them with certain essentials and a Bible in every purse. If you're interested in attending, the cost is $5, and you can sign up at myibclife.com. Deacon nominations will be accepted through April. Nomination forms can be found at the information hub in the lobby. We are still collecting items for the Stock the Closet. For recommended items and more information, please scan the QR code in your worship guide or get more information at the hub. On May 5th, we will be hosting a career day for all high school or college students who would like to learn more about their next steps, whether this is entering the workforce or continuing their education. You are invited to join. This year, the National Day of Prayer will be on May 4th. This year, we will have some prayer-focused activities on campus. Stay tuned for more information. We have launched our Church Center app for you to sign up for events, view church calendar, or check yourself or your child into a small group class. If you haven't downloaded it yet, you can search for the Church Center app in the App Store or scan one of the QR codes in the Information Hub. Here at Emmanuel, we give tithes and offerings to financially support the ministries of Emmanuel and ministries around the world. Today, we have multiple ways to give. You can give safely and securely at myibclife.com. You can place your cash or check in one of the two black boxes located in the lobby on your way out, or you can give directly from the Church Center app. For even more ways to give, check out our Information Hub's giving portion in the lobby. We hope you have an amazing week, and we look forward to seeing you again.